It wasn't because I was trying to act.
Certainly the Lord is worthy of our praise. He's worthy of our worship. Amen. He's worthy of our attention. Amen. He's worthy of everything that we give him. I don't know about you, but I love him. I appreciate him. Amen. He has done great things. Despite what we're facing in our lives, God is still worthy of our praise. He's still worthy of our worship. He's still worthy of our very best. Amen. And we come to give him our very best. We didn't come, amen, just to lay around, sit around, complaining, upset, frustrated, feeling bad. We came to give God our best praise, our best worship, our best attention, amen. He deserves everything that we give him. He deserves it all, amen. And so we came to give it to him. I don't know what you came to do, but I came to lift him up. I came to magnify him. I came to bless him on today, amen. We're going to get right into the word on today in the book of St. Luke. St. Luke, we'll turn chapter number 19. Hallelujah. Amen. Grab your Bibles. Even if you're at home, grab your Bibles. Amen. And we reverence the reading of the word of the Lord. We want to follow along. Stay with us. We always encourage you to study the scriptures outside of the church context. Read the scripture. Get familiar with what we're studying, what we bring it to you. Hallelujah. Amen. The book of St. Luke, chapter number 19. And this is Palm Sunday. Today is Palm Sunday. Amen. Even if you're home, we're celebrating Palm Sunday. Amen. Today, to represent resurrection season, if you will. Jesus' resurrection on next week, we're going to celebrate it. Amen. Even from our living rooms, if we can, we're going to celebrate the risen Savior. We have a risen Savior, a risen King. He got up out of the grave. Amen. He's no longer dead, and so we should no longer be dead. Amen. No matter what situations that cause you to want to be dead or lay down and die, amen, you are not dead. We serve a risen Savior. Amen. We have a reason to praise Him. We have a reason to lift Him up. I don't care what dead situations have happened in your life, what things have happened to cause you to feel dead on the inside. Amen. No matter what's happened to make you feel dead, amen, make you feel like you want to give up, amen, God is good, and we serve a risen Savior. St. Luke chapter number 19. Chapter number 19. Amen. We'll look at verse 28 through 40. This is Palm Sunday. Amen. We're looking at the triumphant entry of our Lord. Amen. And recognizing His goodness, His grace, and His mercy. Hallelujah. He has done great things. He has been great. And He is greatly to be praised. Certainly we love Him. Amen. We do give honor to God, to the Spirit of Christ, to my lovely wife. Amen, who is here with us, and to our children, to my mom as well, she's here with us. Amen, we thank God for her. We thank God for all of you who are watching, amen, online or scrolling past, seeing what's taking place. We thank God for His goodness, amen. The vision of our church, New Journey Church, is to be a church that spreads the good news of Jesus Christ to a world accustomed to hearing bad news, and to be a constant reminder that in Christ, you can always start again, amen. What a blessing it is to be able to start again. We thank God for new starts, fresh opportunities, for amen, for change. What a blessing it is. He don't hold me to yesterday. If I acknowledge it, if I repent for it, He's not going to hold me to yesterday. He's not going to hold me to what was. He's not going to hold me to my mistakes. He's not going to hold me to my past. He's not going to hold me to what happened to me. He's not going to hold me to those things. He gives me a new chance, a new opportunity to start over, to start fresh. Amen. A clean slate. What a blessing. Hallelujah. Amen. I know people hold you to it. Amen. People hold you. Once a drunk, always a drunk. Once a liar, always a liar. Once a cheater, always a cheater. Once a this, once a that. Amen. But thank God. Amen. I used to be one. Yes, you're right. Amen. You can say whatever it was that you want to say because I was there. Amen. You can say whatever you want to say about me because it's true. Amen. I have been there. I have done that. I acknowledge that. But God has given me a new chance. He's given me a new opportunity. He's given me, amen, a new thing. I can't deny what you're talking about. Yes, that's true. I was there. I said what I said. I did what I did. I didn't mean to. Amen. I didn't mean any harm, but I did it. Amen. And I have to admit that I did it, but God didn't hold me to it. And I thank God. Amen. I thank God. I thank God. He gives us a new chance. He gives us a new opportunity, and that's what new journeys are all about. So we thank God for new journeys and new opportunities, amen, to start fresh with the Lord. God has been good. And we acknowledge you, visitors, amen, watching online, amen. We thank God for you. We thank God for you tuning in, amen. And we want to acknowledge Sister, my aunt, Audrey. She couldn't be here with us, which nobody can because of what's going on in the world. A couple weeks ago, she had a birthday, so we always acknowledge our birthdays here. So we want to acknowledge her. I don't know if she's watching, but we want to acknowledge her. She had a birthday a couple weeks ago. And just this week, she had a 20-year celebration for wedding, for her wedding. 20 years married. Amen. What a blessing it is. If we had a room full of people, we would clap. Amen. So I encourage you, clap at home. That's a blessing. Clap. Amen. Your hand and let her know, amen, that you appreciate, amen, her sticking it out. It's not always been easy. Amen. I'm sure it's not been easy. I'm sure it's been days that was difficult. I'm sure it's been days of 20 years. I'm sure she had a few days. Amen. It was difficult. It was tough and challenging, but she stuck it out. Some marriages don't last 20 minutes nowadays. Amen. But hers lasted 20 years, and we want to acknowledge that. We want to celebrate her. Amen. And Kennedy, amen. Kennedy, man, she is turned another year older just today. Today is her birthday on Palm Sunday. She's celebrating, amen, her birthday on Palm Sunday. As we celebrate the triumphant entry of our Lord, she's celebrating her birthday. So I don't know if she's watching, but we want to tell her happy birthday. Amen. All the way, amen, from where we are, we want to acknowledge you today. Amen. God is good. He is worthy. Amen. We want to definitely look at St. Luke chapter number 19 and get on out your way. Amen. God is so good. He's so worthy of our praise. Amen. I'm going to read a bunch of verses. Amen. But we want to acknowledge these verses. Amen. This is Holy Week. Good Friday is on Friday. Holy Saturday. Amen. And not too long, you can't forget Resurrection Sunday. Amen. What a powerful day it is that he got up, amen, out of the grave. And we're excited about that. But today we're going to focus on the Palm Sunday. Amen. We ask that everyone in this room stand in reverence to the reading of the word. Amen. We encourage you at home to stand in knowledge, the reading of the word. Amen. We say, listen, even though you're not here, you can act like you're here. Get dressed. Get ready to come on in. Amen. And serve the Lord and worship the Lord with us. St. Luke chapter number 19, verses 28 through 40. The scripture says, when Jesus had said these things, he went on ahead and going up to Jerusalem. And as he approached Bethpage and Bethany, at a place called the Mount of Olives, he sent two disciples and said to them, go into the village ahead of you. And as you enter the village, you will find a donkey tied there on which no one has ever sat. Untie the donkey and bring it to me. And if anyone asks you, why are you untying this donkey? Just say this, the Lord needs it. Amen. Say it with me. Amen. Even from your living rooms, say it with me. The Lord needs it. Amen. The Lord needs it. So they went from there and they found just what Jesus told them they would find. And they were untying the donkey. His owners came and said, what are you doing? Why are you untying the donkey? Verse 34, say it again with me. The Lord needs it. Amen. The Lord needs it. And they said unto the owner of the donkey. Then they brought the donkey to Jesus, and after throwing robes on the donkey, they helped Jesus get on upon it. And he was going along, spreading their robes on the road. Now there came to the path down the Mount of Olives, the whole crowd of disciples began to praise the Lord joyfully with a loud voice for all the miracles they had seen. The King who comes in the name of the Lord, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. They were giving him praise as he came along, peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven. Some of the Pharisees saw the crowd and they told him, teacher, rebuke these people. Tell them to be quiet. And Jesus answered and said unto them, I tell you this, if they were to be quiet, if they were to keep silent, the very rocks would cry out in their place. Amen. Jesus told his disciples what was going to take place. He was fulfilling a prophecy, amen, that was taking place, amen, in the book of Zechariah. He told them to go and do something, amen, that was basically fulfilling the prophecy. Amen. He told them in verse 30, he said, go into the village and get a donkey. You'll find a donkey. And when you see the donkey, he's going to be tied up. Untie the donkey and bring him to me. And if anybody asks you why you're doing this, tell them the Lord needs it. Amen. The Lord needs it. And just what Jesus said happened. They asked, why were you untying this donkey? Amen. This donkey who seems to be just minding his own business. This donkey who seems to be irrelevant. This donkey who seems to be insignificant. What are you doing to my donkey? What are you doing to this thing? Why are you touching it? Why are you untying it? Why are you even having shown any type of interest in it? They said in verse 34, because the Lord needs it. Amen. The Lord needs it. And for a little while, we're going to use for this thought. Amen. We're going to borrow this clause from this 31st and the 34th verse. The Lord needs you. Amen. The Lord needs you. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Today is Palm Sunday, and if you are here with us, amen, we would order palms, amen, that you could have tangibly with you to celebrate, amen, and signify the palms that filled the street as Jesus rode in on that donkey. Palm Sunday is significant because it represents the last week of Jesus' life on earth. Palm Sunday also marks the beginning of Holy Week. The Holy Week commemorates and reminds us of what Jesus did. Amen. The events that led up to his death, his burial, and ultimate resurrection. During the time of our text, the Jews were getting ready for the Passover festival. And the Jews were traveling south, amen, to Jerusalem. Typically, they were traveling to Jerusalem from all over Israel. They were traveling to Jerusalem to get to the Passover festival. In the text, Jesus was in Bethany and Bethpage near the Mount of Olives, the scripture declares, and right outside of Jerusalem. He was almost there. He was almost about to be there. But when he got there, he would ride in on the donkey, as we know now as the triumphant entry. In all of this, Jesus riding in on the donkey and the disciples going to get the donkey and all that kind of stuff fulfilled the prophecy in Zechariah chapter 9, verse 9. It says, "Rejoice, O people of Zion. Shout with triumph, O people of Jerusalem. Look, your king is coming to you, and he is righteous and he is victorious, yet he is humble." I'm going to say that again. Your king is coming to you, so you ought to rejoice, O people of Zion. Shout and triumph, O people of Jerusalem. I'm here to declare to you today the people of God should be rejoicing. The people of God should be shouting. The people of God should be excited. Amen. I don't know what you're going through. I don't know what you're facing. I know this virus has got us down, some of us down. But I'm here to tell you the people of God, the church of God, should be rejoicing. Amen. We should be happy. This is a season of resurrection. This is the resurrection of the Lord. We should be excited. We should be shouting because we have something to shout about. Amen. We have something to praise God for. Amen. My pastor will say this. Listen, there's enough to be sad about. There's enough to complain about. You need to learn to find something to rejoice about. Find something to praise God for. Amen. You got a reason to lift them up. You got a reason, amen, to lift your hands. Yes, your problems tell you have a reason to lay there depressed. Your problems tell you have a reason to be defeated. Amen. But I'm telling you here, all the way from Cleveland, Ohio, to let you know that you have a reason to rejoice. Amen. You have a reason to give him glory. You have a reason to praise his name. He is worthy of the praise. Shout, O Israel. Amen. Look, lift your hands, O Zion. You have a reason to give him glory. Your king is coming to you. And he is righteous and he is victorious. Amen. He sits on high. He looks down low. He does all the things. He is the one who said, "Let there be light," and light appeared. Amen. He's the one that created the universe. Amen. With the sound of his voice. He's the one that was and is to come. He's the one that is the promise keeper and the way maker. Amen. He's the righteous redeemer. He is all that he said he is. And the scripture says, yet he is also humble. He's coming in riding on a donkey. Amen. And we thank God for his entry. You see, many of the Jews knew that Jesus was the promised Messiah. They knew that Jesus was the one that will fulfill prophecy. They knew that Jesus was the one that was going to do what God declared that he would do. God foretold that he would do. They knew Jesus was him. And they thought that Jesus, the Messiah, if you will, that Jesus would be the one to save them from the Roman government, to save them from the Roman oppression. But Jesus' mission was a little different than what they expected. You see, he did come to establish a new kingdom. Amen. But this kingdom would not be of this earth. Of his kingdom, there will be no end. Amen. He came now to establish an earthly kingdom per se. Amen. He wanted his kingdom to be in the earth, but he didn't want to establish an earthly kingdom, amen, and leave it. Amen. He wanted to establish the kingdom of heaven. And that's what he came to establish, the kingdom of heaven. The kingdom of heaven is not a place. The kingdom of heaven, amen, is in our hearts, amen. And he wants us to realize the kingdom of heaven is a set of principles, a set of a mindset, a way of living that we ought to adopt as the people of God. And so he came amen, to do what he said he would do. He was the Messiah, amen, promised Messiah, the resurrected king. He was all of those things, but he also came in humble. He came in riding. And he came to establish his kingdom, amen, the heavenly kingdom, the kingdom of heaven, a kingdom that will come never come to an end. But many of us are like these Jews. You see, the Jews put Jesus in a box. They put Jesus in a box, amen, a political box, if you will. They put him in a box and say, well, listen, his kingdom will destroy Roman's oppression over us, and we will show Rome who's boss, amen. But that's what we do. We put Jesus in a box. We put him in a political box. We put him in a racial box. We put him in a religious box, amen. We put him in a box that makes us comfortable. We put him in a box that we can understand. Amen. But we must understand that Jesus is not in a box. Amen. He's outside of the box. He's not a white man. Jesus is not a black man. Jesus is not a Republican. He's not a Democrat. Jesus is not a Catholic. Jesus is not a Protestant. He's bigger than your religion. He's bigger than your race. He's bigger than your politics. Amen. He's bigger than your earthly agenda. He's bigger than whatever box you have placed him in based on your understanding. He's bigger than whatever you said about him. He's bigger than your last experience. Jesus is bigger. We need to understand this. You see, many of us are only interested in Jesus because he advances our agenda, if you will. We're only using him to advance our agenda. We're only using him, amen, as a genie in a bottle. We have our three wishes in our head, and we're using this prayer bead and this word of God, amen, to get what we feel like we want out of life. Amen. But we have to realize Jesus is bigger than whatever your agenda is. We serve God. God does not serve us. Amen. I'm going to say that again. Amen. Somebody need to hear that. Amen. We serve God. Amen. And if you're not serving him, you should be serving God. God does not serve you. Amen. We should be using our opportunity to advance God's kingdom instead of using and twisting the scripture to advance our own. Come on, somebody. Amen. We should be using this time and our opportunity to advance God's kingdom instead of twisting the scripture to advance. So Jesus, the scripture declares, he rode in on into Jerusalem on a donkey on that first Palm Sunday. But most kings would have rode in on a stallion to show their power. Amen. Most kings, amen, would have got a big old horse, amen, to signify their authority. But Jesus came in on a donkey, amen, although he was powerful. Although, amen, he was the King of kings and the Lord of lords. Although he had done so powerful things, amen, he came in on the donkey to show his humility. Come on, somebody. Although he is the King of kings, he came in on the donkey to show the importance of being humble. Amen. You better humble yourself before the mighty hand of God. Amen. But we, before he rode in on the donkey, we look at the scripture. We draw our text. He told the disciples to go get it. Verse 30, he told them, listen, go into the village. As you enter the village, you will see a young donkey tied there that nobody has ever ridden. Untie the donkey and bring it to me. You see, Jesus sent his disciples to get the donkey so that he can ride in on Jerusalem. Before he rode in on the donkey, he sent his disciples to go get it. That donkey was tied to a tree. So the disciples, before they could bring the donkey to Jesus, they first had to untie the donkey. Then they could bring it to Jesus. And just like that donkey, amen, the Lord came and found me where I was. Come on, somebody. Amen. I didn't come to him. He came and found me where I was. I was actually running from God. I didn't want to have nothing to do with God. I didn't want to have nothing to do with the church. Amen. I was just scrolling through Facebook. Amen. And I just happened upon this message right here today. Amen. He found me where I was. Amen. I wasn't going to no church. So God brought the church to me. Amen. I wasn't going step on foot. Amen. And hear no preacher. Amen. So God brought the preacher to my house. Amen. To my living room. Amen. He came and found where I was. He came and found me. You see, when he found me, I was tied up with sin, just like that donkey. Amen. When he found me, I was tied up with iniquity, just like that donkey. When he found me, I was tied up with unrighteousness, just like that donkey. I was tied up, amen, doing my own thing. I was tied up, amen, trying to advance my own agenda. I was tied up. I was not ready for God. I was not ready to be used of God. God was not on my radar. I had no interest in doing nothing for God. When he found me, amen, he came up, found me where I was, and I was tied down, messed up, not fit to be used for the kingdom of God. Come on, many of us are still tied down. Uh-oh, I'm talking now. Amen, I'm coming down your road. Many of us are still tied down with sin. Come on, amen. He is trying to get our attention, but we're still tied down with unrighteousness. Many of us are still tied down living our sinful lives and obeying our ungodly and unholy desires. We are still tied down with our unrighteous aspirations. Many of us are still tied down. You see, I was untied and loose by the Lord, and now he is using me. Amen. Because I realized the Lord needed me. Amen. You need to realize, untie yourself, amen, from the things that you're doing that have you tied down, amen, and permits you from serving the Lord the way you should serve him. We have to realize the Lord needs us. Amen. The Lord needs you. Come on, the Lord needs you. Jesus told his disciples, if anybody asks you what's going on and why you are messing with this donkey, he said, tell them the Lord needs it. You see, this donkey was insignificant until the Lord showed interest in it. That's good. That's good. That's worth writing down. If you're taking notes, amen, that's worth writing down. This donkey was insignificant until the Lord showed interest in it. You see, this Jesus made this seemingly insignificant donkey. Now it's remembered and celebrated. Amen. When we think of Palm Sunday, we think of Jesus riding in on the donkey. Amen. We think about that donkey, and the donkey is remembered. The donkey is celebrated. Yet, before Jesus showed interest in it, it was tied down to a tree. Nobody thought about it. That's why the owner said, why are you doing? What are you doing to my donkey? Why are you touching it? Amen. It's not bothering you. It's not bothering nobody. Why do you need it? He said, the Lord needs it. Hallelujah. You see, in biblical times, a donkey was considered an unclean animal. Yet the Lord showed interest in that unclean animal. Why would the Lord be interested in an unclean animal? Why would the Lord want to use something seemingly insignificant? Why would the Lord choose to ride on a donkey, amen, into Jerusalem instead of a big old horse, amen, to signify his power? I don't know. I can't answer that. Amen. The same question I have, why would the Lord want to save somebody like me? Amen. Why would the Lord want to use somebody like me? Why would the Lord make my insignificant life, amen, important in his kingdom? Amen. I don't know, but I'm grateful. Come on, somebody. I can't answer that question. I don't know why he would do what he does. I don't understand his grace. Amen. But I'm grateful for it. Amen. I can't say thank you. Amen. I can't say I appreciate it. I can't live up to, amen, the things that he has given me so that he don't waste his grace on me. I'm grateful. I'm grateful. You see, he used that unclean donkey the same way he used uses another unworthy man like me. Amen. He used that unclean donkey the same way he uses a wretched man like me. He used that unclean donkey the same way he used an unclean sinner like me. He uses, amen, us, amen, although we don't deserve it. He uses us although we're not worthy. He uses us although we seem insignificant. Our lives seem insignificant. We're tied down with things that do not please him. He still wants to use us. I was tied down with sin, but the Lord needed me. I was tied down with sin, but one day he came and found me where I was, and he untied me. Amen. I was tied down with sin, but he untied me. Amen. He came and got me. Amen. And now he's using me for his glory. He made my insignificant life significant. Amen. He knows my shortcomings, yet he made my insignificant life significant. He knows I'm not perfect, yet he still makes me significant. He knows about my mistakes and my shortcomings and some of the things we did on purpose. Come on, somebody. You called it a mistake, amen, but you knew what you were doing when you did it. Amen. You contemplated it, you premeditated it, and you knew it was wrong, and you contemplated the wrong, and you still went after it. Amen. But he still knew, you know, all about all of those things, and he still uses you. He still makes your life significant. You see, until we surrender our life to the Lord, our lives will be significant, insignificant. I'm gonna say that again. Until we surrender our lives to the Lord, our lives will seem so insignificant. We must stop wasting time being tied down with sin and realize that the Lord needs you. Amen. Many of us hear a message like this and we ask the preacher, okay, preacher, that sounds good, but how can the Lord need me? How can the Lord use me when I'm sinful? Come on. But the Lord still needs you. How can the Lord use me when I'm not perfect? Amen. But the Lord still needs you. How can the Lord use me when I'm not where I need to be? I'm not where I should be. I don't live how I should live. I don't
come. Like I should come, I don't tithe. Like I should tithe, I don't do the things that I should do. How can the Lord use me? You don't know my past. You don't know my history. You don't know all the things that I've done. Amen. All the things that I'm ashamed of. You don't realize, amen, all the things, amen, that I'm still currently doing right now that I'm not proud of. How can the Lord use me? He still needs you. You see, we think because we're not a preacher that God can't use us, which keeps us tied down with sin. Amen. It's a trap of the enemy. You think because you don't have a title in the church. You think because nobody knows your name. You think because, amen, you're not on a choir or a praise team. You're not a deacon. You're not an usher. You're not this. You're not that in the church. You can live however you want to live. Amen. You don't need a title to walk upright before God. Amen. You don't need somebody, amen, to give you a position to walk upright before God. You don't need somebody, amen, to acknowledge who you are, to give God your best, amen, to walk upright before him in your everyday life. Amen. Just because you're not a preacher don't mean your life does not matter. Just because you don't have a title or position don't mean that God cannot use you right where you are. I'm here to declare to you today, amen, God needs you. Flaws and all, he needs you, he needs you, he needs you. Amen. Mistakes and all, he needs you, he needs you. Now, it's not a license to keep on going down the wrong path, amen, but realize he needs me. And so now I'm going to get myself together. Amen. When you realize that somebody more important needs you, amen, you say, wait a minute, maybe my life does matter. Amen. Maybe I can stop doing what I'm doing. Maybe I can stop making the mistakes that I'm making. Maybe it does matter that I'm going down the wrong path. Maybe it does matter that I'm making the wrong decisions. Maybe it does matter. Maybe my life is significant. You need to realize your life is significant because the Lord needs you. Yes. Amen. He needs you. He needs you. You see, we think because we've been baptized and we gave our life to the Lord at an early age, that's all it takes. We don't need to do anything else. No, 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 no. The Lord needs you. My pastor said this, listen, if you got saved and that's all you got to do, when you come to the altar, you might as well have died right there. He might as well took you to heaven. Your life has a purpose beyond getting saved. Your life has a purpose beyond getting baptized. Amen. Your life has a purpose. You need to be serving God in your everyday life. Lord needs you. You see, these mistakes, these things that we are caught up in, the fact that we don't have a title, a position, keeps us tied down with sin. I'm not a preacher. It don't matter if I smoke, if I drink, it don't really matter. Amen. I'm not this, I'm not that. I'm not perfect. The Lord knows my heart. Even though it's desperately wicked, and who can know it? Yeah, the scripture says. Amen. Your heart is deceitful and desperately wicked. Amen. It wants to do the wrong thing. It wants to go down the wrong path. But you talking about the Lord knows my heart. Yeah. He knows your heart. It's desperately wicked. You need to surrender your heart to him. You need to give him your best because he needs you. He needs you. You see, you don't need a platform to be used of God. You don't need a title to be used of God. You don't need a big church, a big audience to be used of God. Amen. You don't need a large following to be used of God. Amen. We don't have a room full of people right now, but I know God is using me, and I thank God for that. Amen. We don't need a microphone to be used of God. All you need is a willing heart, and God can use you. Come on, somebody. All you need is a broken spirit, and God can use you. All you need, amen, is a sincere yes, and God can use you. All you need is a made-up mind, and God can use you. God can use you wherever you are. Amen. I don't care what platform you have. If you don't have a platform at all, he can use you at the house. Amen. During this quarantine right now, he can use you on your job. Amen. Amen. He can use you. Amen. With your children. He can use you wherever you are. Amen. Let the Lord use you. He needs you. Stop with this spiritual procrastination. I put God off for later. I get to it. When I get to it, I'm going to do it when I get serious. I'm going to do it when I get myself together. Stop putting God off for later. Do it right now. He needs you now. It's time to serve the Lord right now because he needs you. He needs you. You see, you can reach people that other people can't reach. You can reach people that the preacher can't reach. You can reach people that people with a platform can't reach. You can reach people, amen, that the religious elite won't even try to reach. You can do it. God needs you, but you're too afraid. Amen. He can use you. He needs you, but you're too ashamed, amen, of him. Amen. He said, if you be ashamed of me, I'll be ashamed of you. You can't afford for God to be ashamed of you. Too ashamed to stand up for Christ. Too ashamed to make a difference. I'm here to tell you today, the Lord needs you. You could meet people that the pastor would never meet. They ain't want to come to church, but the church is in you. Amen. And so you can bring the church right where they are. Amen. You can bring the church to your job. You can bring the church to your family. You can bring the church. They don't want to come to church. Amen. They sick of the church. They've been hurting the church. Amen. So they can. You can bring them something that they never had before, but you're too afraid. You're too tied up with sin. Amen. Loose yourself and realize the Lord needs you. It's not just on the preacher. It's not just on the evangelist. It's not just on the people on the TV. It's on you. You can be used of God right where you are. So the Lord needs you. He told his disciples to bring him the donkey, and after they brought him the donkey, he rode into Jerusalem. And as he rode, the scripture declares that the people put down their palms, and they put down coats, and they put down like robes and different things to make his travel easier. Matthew chapter 28, verses 8 and 9 said a large crowd came out, and they spread their cloaks and cloaks on the road. And while others cut branches down from the tree, these palms, and they spread them down on the road. This is what Palm Sunday signifies. This is what Palm Sunday is all about, them making Jesus' way easier. The crowds that went ahead of him and rose and shouted Hosanna in the highest. They shouted amen with their mouths, and they took down the robes, and they took down the coats, and they cut down branches to make the way easy as he rode in on the donkey. And they used their mouth to lift him up. They said Hosanna in the highest. Amen. Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven. Amen. As Jesus rode the donkey, the people put their coats and things on the road to make his life easier, to make his travel easier. They cried out, Hosanna in the highest, to the Son of David. They cried out, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. They cried out, amen, with praises on their lips. You see, they were treating Jesus like a king because they realized who he was. They were treating him like a king because they understood that he was the promised Messiah. But those same people who sung those praises on Sunday are the same ones that were yelling in the crowd, crucify him, just a few days later. Come on, somebody. Amen. Those same people who put out cloaks and put out coats and put out branches and did all these things and praised his name with their mouth, and they said, Hosanna in the highest, and blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Those same people, it was a different crowd. It was the same crowd. Crucify him, the same people just a few days later. It wasn't later that year. It wasn't later that month. It was a few days later. Amen. In the same way, the same people something that encourage you will sometimes discredit you. Come on, somebody. The same people, amen, that have your back will use the access to stab you in that back. Amen. The same people that celebrate you will sometimes also criticize you. Amen. Don't let it work. Amen. Don't let it discourage you. Don't let it distract you. Don't believe the hype, whether it's good or bad. Amen. Just keep focused on the Lord. That's why you got to be humble. Amen. Because the same people that praise you, amen, the same people that say, I'm behind you, I'm with you, are the same people that will turn their back and walk away. Have nothing to do with you. Amen. You see, on Palm Sunday, these people were praising the Lord. Amen. They were lifting up the name of Jesus. They were treating him like a king. And they were cursing him just a few days later. The same people that were praising him, amen, were cursing him just a few days later. Are you praising God on Sunday and then cursing him out by Monday? Uh-oh. Are you praising God on Sundays and by Monday you forgot how good he was? Amen. You lift your hands in worship and you tell God how good he is, and you cry and you shout and you dance and you tell him hallelujah. But by the time you get home, amen, they got a light, your lights are off and you don't know what to do. Amen. You forgot about how good God was. Are you praising him on Sunday and by Monday you forgot what you have said and declared out of your mouth? Stop praising God and then cursing him. Come on, somebody. Stop praising him on Sunday and then doubting him by Sunday night. Amen. By the time you get in the car, amen, you got your worldly music on 107.9. Amen. You got it on and you forgot all about how good is our God, how great is our God. Sing with me. You forgot all about your praises. Come on. Stop praising him. And then cursing at the same time. He's good. Amen. He's good on Sunday. Amen. We come with our Sunday best and we look great in front of the pastor. Amen. We tell good God how good he is. Amen. But by the time we get home, we forgot. He's the same God on Sunday as he is on Monday. Come on. He's the same God on Tuesday as he is on Sunday. Amen. He's the same God on Wednesday as he was on Sunday. He's the same God on Friday night when you don't know what's going to happen. You don't know what's going to take place and you're feeling a little lonely and you feel him some kind of way. He's the same God. He's the same God. Amen. You need to lift him up. Amen. I promise you. Amen. When you begin to lift up the name of Jesus, your problems won't seem so big. When you begin to lift up the name of Jesus, your issues won't seem so large. When you begin to lift up the name of Jesus, you'll realize and understand, amen, that I can get through anything in the presence of God. In his presence is fullness of joy. Amen. He's the same God. He's the same God. We need to learn to bless him at all times. Good times, bad times, troubled times, times when I'm up, times when I'm down, times when I don't know, times when I'm unsure. I need to bless the Lord at all times.
Yes.
Let his praise be continually in our mouth. So the people praise the Lord. Amen. They was letting them know, blessed is the name, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. They was lifting him up. They was saying all these good things. They was putting out their coats and cloaks and palms to make his way easy. They was singing, saying all the right things. And as they were talking, the religious leaders in verse 40 told them, listen, tell these people to be quiet. Shut these people up. Can I say shut up in church?
Yep.
Too late, I already did. Amen. I said it. Amen. So get ready to close. The religious leaders, they were upset. They were angry. Amen. They were upset and they told Jesus, listen, tell these people to shut up. Tell them to be quiet. But Jesus told them, if I tell them to be quiet, if I tell them to stop praising me, if I tell them and they listen, the scripture declares the very rocks will cry out in their place. In other words, no matter what's going on, the will of God will take place with you or without you. Come on. Amen. The will of God will take place with you or without you. You see, the Lord needs you. Don't get it twisted, though. If you don't surrender, if you stay tied down with sin, his will continue to go on. It just won't go on with you. We flatter ourselves because we got the invitation that the Lord needs us. We flatter ourselves and we act as if we have a choice. But we have to realize it's a privilege to serve the Lord.
Amen.
We have to understand that it's an honor to serve God.
Yeah.
Amen. It's a blessing to be called on by God, although I'm not worthy, although I don't deserve it. Amen. You see, the fact that he called me sometimes makes me feel arrogant like I deserve to be called. No. Don't get arrogant. Amen. Don't get it twisted. Don't sit there as if, amen, you're doing God a favor when you show up. No. He needs you, but realize it's a privilege that he called you in the first place. It's an honor. It's a privilege. Amen. You see, he didn't make us robots. He gives us a free will. He gives us the right to choose. He gives us the power to make decisions. I'm going to say that again. That's worth writing down right there. Don't miss it. He didn't make us robots. He gives us free will. He gives us the right to choose. He gives us the power to make decisions. But sometimes we allow that power to go to our heads. We allow that power sometimes. And we use that power to make the wrong decision. That's deep. Don't miss it. That's really good. We use the power that God has given us to make decisions, and we make the wrong decision.
Yeah.
You see, you have a lot of choices, a lot of options. They seem valid at the time, but you have to realize there's only one right choice. Amen. Although you have options and although you have choices, there's only one right choice, like multiple choice, A, B, C, or D. There's only one right choice among them. Amen. Although there are many choices, all the other choices are false choices. You have to make the right choice. Jesus is always the right choice. Amen. I'm going to say that again. You got to make the right choice. Jesus is always the right choice. If you're not choosing Jesus, you're choosing incorrectly. Amen. I'm going to say that again. If you're not choosing Jesus in your life, amen, I know you got a lot of choices. I know you have a lot of options out there. I know people are saying you can choose any religion you want. You can do whatever you want. Amen. It's your choice. Okay, that's true. But I'm here to tell you, any other choice besides Jesus, you're making the wrong choice.
Yeah.
You're choosing incorrectly. You see, if God is not first in your life, you got to get your priorities straight.
That's right.
If God is not first in your life, then you need to get your priorities straight. When you realize that the Lord is calling you, when will you realize that the Lord can use you? Yes, you. Even with your hangups and your mistakes. Don't mean that you got to keep doing your mistakes. But he can use you. He can clean you up and change your whole life. When will you realize that the Lord needs you? The Lord needs you, but you're tied down with sin. He needs you, but you're missing in action. And then you refuse to show up. And man, he needs you, but the rocks are crying out in your place. Stop allowing the rocks to cry out in your place. Stop allowing people who came in after you to have more zeal for God than you do. Stop allowing excuses and self-pity to rule your life. Stop allowing yourself to be tied down with sin. Stop allowing the power to choose to cause you to make the wrong decision. Amen. The Lord needs you. Amen. We have to realize, amen, the power to choose. Amen. We need to use that power to surrender and surrender that power to God. Stop allowing the power to choose to make you feel like you're doing God a favor when you show up. You're doing God a favor when you do the right thing. You're doing God a favor, amen, because you inconvenience yourself to leave your sin for a little while so you can be untied for a minute. You showed up, now you're about to go back to your sin. No, it don't work that way. You are not the gift. God is the gift. Amen. The fact that he called you is a gift. The fact that he called you is an honor. And you need to realize you're not doing God a favor when you do the right thing. The Lord needs you. Not only does he need you, he wants you. Yeah. Amen. That's a powerful thing. Amen. He needs us. But not only does he need us, he desires us. He wants us. Amen. He wants us to live right. He wants us to get it right. He wants us to choose the right way. Amen. He's calling you. He's trying to get your attention. Amen. And he will use any and everything that he can to get your attention. You won't come to him, so he's bringing it to you. Amen. The Lord needs you. He wants you. Won't you surrender? It's a privilege to be called of God. It's an honor to be used of God. Amen. Once you realize the honor that you have and surrender, won't you come? Amen. The Lord needs you. Amen. Put your hands together, even at home. Amen. Thank God for his word and today. Amen. The Lord needs you. Amen. Hallelujah. God is so good. And you're so worthy of our praise. Listen, we came to praise him. Came to lift him up. We came to honor him. Amen. And I ask, even online today, amen, that you give. Amen. We have multiple ways to give. And although we're not in person, you can still give. Amen. Amen. You can give in tithes and in offerings. As a member, you should be tithing anyway. So make sure you give, and it shall be given. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. God said, prove me, try me. See, when I pour you out a blessing that you don't have room to receive. We ask that you give. Amen. The church is still going on. Amen. You may not be here, but the church of God is still going on. We still have bills. We still have things taking place. But that's not why you give. You don't give because of pressure. You don't give because the preacher had bills or the pastor had, the church had bills. You don't give because, amen, you want to show up or show out per se. You give out of honor to God for all that he has blessed you with. You give, amen, to show God that you appreciate what he has done. You give to show God that you're a steward. You see, the 10% that you get is not your money. You think it's yours. That's what I'm saying. You tied down with sin so much that the sin got you messed up in your head. It makes you think that you're doing God a favor when you give. You're not doing God a favor. You're just bringing God what's his. He's trusted you and seeing what you're going to do. Every time you get paid is a test. Are you going to give God what's his, or are you going to keep it for yourself? Are you going to give God what's his, or are you going to spend it on cheeseburgers? Are you going to give God what's his, or are you going to buy your kids some shoes with it? No, listen, learn to give the way God has said to give, and that's how you get blessed. Amen. I'm trying to get you blessed. I'm trying to get you outside of the mentality that the world has given you. Learn to give. Stop worrying about what you're going to get in return. Give, and God will do what he said. He said, prove me. See what I pour you out of blessing that you don't have room enough to receive. If you don't want to give because you got an attitude, you think the pastor gonna take the money and use it for this or for that, listen, you give them with the wrong mentality, you should keep your money. But if you learn to give with the right attitude, amen, God can bless you exceeding abundantly above all that you could ask or think. I encourage you to give. We have multiple ways. You may not be able to give cash, but you can give Cash App. Amen. You can give text 216-393-3711. I'm going to say that again, 216-393-3711. You can give. Amen. You can give multiple ways. You can give on our website. The website is in the link there, njcle.com/giving. You can give. Amen. We encourage you to give, 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 give. Amen. Don't be shy in your giving. Just because you can't show up here, don't mean you cannot give. We ask that you give. Amen. Support your ministry. Support the church. Support us. Amen. As we continue to go forth and bring the church to you. Amen. Amen. We thank God for you. We love you so much. We miss you. Amen. We wish you were here to hug us. Amen. We wish you we could live to, you were here to kiss us. We wish you were here so we can show you the love of God. Amen. But we love you with the love of the Lord. We give you virtual hugs right now. Amen. We send them to you. Amen. And we know it's going to go back to where
it's
doing.
It's not njcle.com. It's newjourneycle.com.
Oh, amen. My wife corrected me. New Journey CLE. You got the link there. If you're watching online, you got the link there. Just click the link. Amen. Go to giving. But it's New Journey CLE. .com. She's correct in that, amen. I don't know, our NJCLE is the Cash App. Amen, so newjourneycle.com/giving, you can give there, and so we thank God for you, and we love you so much, amen. Even though you're not here, my wife's still correcting me, she's still doing that, amen. That's her job, I guess, amen. We thank God. Listen, we have Bible study on Zoom, so if you're interested in that, contact us, comment, amen, in the link so we can get you the information to Zoom. So we can do Bible study. You can join in on Bible study with us. Amen. We still are doing Bible study. Yes, we have Bible study. Amen. We just don't meet in person. We do it on Zoom. Amen. Just like the live stream, we still are going on with that. So we encourage you to come and join us as well. Amen. And we're praying. Amen. For you to wrap it up. The stay home order, I think, goes into effect tomorrow. Just start enforcing things. So make sure that you stay at home. Make sure you do what you got to do. Stay social distance. Get masks. Wear something over your head. Yourself wear gloves. Do what you got to do. And then stay safe, especially those ones that's going out in the midst of the epidemic. Healthcare workers and store employees who are doing what they got to do. We honor you. There's dignity in every job. We honor you today. We salute you. We thank God for you. Amen. So we honor you and we thank God and we ask, be careful, be careful, be careful. Do whatever you can. Wash your hands. Don't touch your face. Whatever you can do, amen, to protect yourself, make sure you do it. But whatever you do, don't walk in fear. Amen. This too shall pass. Amen. The Lord is still on the throne. He is still in charge. No matter what takes place, no matter what happens, no matter how hard it gets, no matter how difficult it gets, this should bring you closer to your faith instead of turning you away from your faith. Amen. Some of all of us have questions, but those questions can be answered through the Word of God. They can be answered. I don't care what question you have, they can be answered through the Word of God. And if your heart is right, God will answer your question. Amen. He will do what he said he would do. If you come in anger and just trying to prove that it's wrong, of course, that's your mind is already made up. But if you come with a right heart, a pure spirit, a sincere and brokenness, God will answer you. He will see about you. I know it's difficult. I know it's hard. And you don't see a way out. Amen. But God is still in charge. Amen. I encourage you, don't lose your faith. Don't give up on God. God has never given up on you. Amen. Even though you gave up on him, he still needs you. He still loves you. He still wants you right where you are. So we thank God for you. Amen. We want to encourage somebody today. Amen. We want to encourage you right where you are. Amen. Keep believing. Keep praying. Keep trusting. Amen. Amen. Listen, be careful and be prayerful. Amen. Be careful and be prayerful. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for your goodness. We thank you for your grace and for your mercy. We pray now that you move like only you can in this place and among us. Move in our nation. Amen. Move in our hearts. Move in our minds. Strengthen us where we build us up where we've been torn down. Lord God, encourage the people who's watching even online right now that you are with them, that you will be with them, that you go before them, that you prepare the way, that you will have your way in their hearts, have your way in their minds. Give them the strength that they need to overcome everything, every anxiety that's trying to overcome them. We pray right now that you would just send financial blessings and financial breakthroughs. Even people who give by faith, Lord, they didn't have a lot, but they gave by faith. Lord, I pray that you would bless them financially, even soon, even this week, that they will see a miracle in their account. That they will see a miracle come, Lord God, in their mailbox. That they will see a miracle take place in their lives. Even if it's not financially or monetarily, that they will see a miracle take place. In the name of Jesus, we pray for people who have contracted the epidemic, the disease. We pray for them right now that you will send peace and healing into our land, that you will send comfort. And people who are dealing with all kind of diseases and all kind of ailments that are not have not risen to the level of awareness like this epidemic has, we pray for them as well right now. Send healing and direction. Lord God, you are bruised for our iniquities, and you are beat for our healing. And we pray right now that you will send healing virtue, Lord God, and that no matter what takes place, that you will make it well with our soul. That we trust you like never before. We believe you like never before. We count on you, and we know that you can do all things but fail. Have your way in our hearts and in our lives. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All of you social distancing, hug somebody, love on somebody. Amen. Show them the love of Christ. Amen. No matter where you are. God bless you. We appreciate you. Tune in.